everyone, welcome back to my channel, or welcome to my channel if you've never been here before. Hey, so in today's video, we're going to be discussing the case of Chris Coldman. This case, it really took me on a whirlwind. I was not expecting any of this to happen. Like, you're going to be pretty shocked. And if you know anything about the Chris Watts case, this case is actually eerily similar to the Chris Watts case. Like, literally, almost everything in this case is identical to the Chris Watts case. And Chris Coleman's parents, they literally stressed me out. I really wanted to slap them because it's parents like this. This is the reason why a lot of men are the way they are today, because I feel like these type of parents, like, they really just made their son feel like God left them in charge of everybody. And it shouldn't be that way. So if you want to know more about Chris Coleman and all of the craziness, then keep on watching. So Christopher Coleman was born on March 20th, 1977 to his parents, Connie and Ron Coleman. Connie and Ron, they were bishops or pastors. Christopher was known to excel in every single thing that he did. He did amazing in school. He was very, very smart. So one day while he was at school, a military recruiter came in. You know how people from the military, they'll come and they'll talk to the class. They'll basically, you know, try to recruit you, give you information just in case you want to join the military after high school and, like, you know, leave their cards or whatever. So Christopher was very, very impressed. And the military recruiter was also very, very impressed by Christopher. So right out of high school, Christopher decided to join the military. So he joined the Marines, and in the Marines, he was a dog handler. So he worked with the canine unit. So he did very, very well in the military as well, as you can imagine. While in the Marines, he was definitely enjoying it, but he started enjoying it even more when he met a young lady. He met this young lady, her name was Sherri Ann Weiss. So Sherri Ann, she was born on July 3rd, 1977, but she wasn't in the Marines, she was actually in the Air Force. So she just happened to be in the canine center studying one day, and she came across Chris, and she was like, oh, well, hello there, how you doing? So ever since that day, they literally became inseparable. So one day, Chris was going home, and he decided to invite Sherri home with him. He wanted to take Sherri home so Sherri can meet his family. They went home, and Chris pulled up in the driveway, and his mom, Connie, was looking out the window, you know, to welcome her baby home, because he's just coming back, you know, from the military. She's super excited to see him. So when he pulled up to the driveway with Sherri, his mom looked out the window, and for her, it was immediately no. She was just like, nope, 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 not doing it, won't do it, no, no. This was even before she even met Sherri. Like, as soon as she saw Sherri, she was just like, nope, nope, that's not it, that's not the one. Chris came upstairs, and Chris introduced Sherri to his lovely mother. He introduced Sherri as his friend. He didn't introduce her as his girlfriend, but obviously, I think his mom already knew what it was. So his mom didn't like her. His dad didn't like her neither. Because as I said, they're pastors, both of them. So they looked at Sherri, and Sherri was a worldly girl in their opinion. She had on shorts. She had a tattoo. She was just not what they envisioned for their son. However, Chris did not care about that at all. Because I would say a few days later, well, not a few days later, but shortly after, probably just a couple months later, Chris was in Illinois again, and he actually called his dad, and he was like, how are you? I'm here in Chicago. And his dad was like, you know, just chilling, I assume. And then this is when he decided to pop the news to his dad, and he was like, well, guess what? I'm married. So they were pissed, as you can imagine. First of all, they didn't even like this girl as his friend, let alone his girlfriend and now his wife. No, they were not having it. So they were pissed. But it was nothing to do at this point because he had already married her. In April of 1998, Sherri and Chris welcomed their first son. His name was Garrett Coleman. And when his father found out that Sherri was pregnant, they actually realized that she was actually pregnant before they got married. So this is what kind of prompted them to get married, because Sherry was actually pregnant and because Chris grew up in a religious setting, he just wanted to do it the traditional way. So just about 2 years later, they welcomed their second baby. His name was Gavin Christopher Coleman. And they decided to settle down in a small town in Illinois called Columbia. And around this time, Chris wanted to be with his family because Sherry was a homemaker. She was staying home with the boys and Chris was still in the military. But Chris wanted to come home so he can be with his kids. He wanted like a less demanding job because obviously the military is pretty demanding. So he wanted something less demanding. So this is when he decided to leave the military so he can be at home with the boys and his wife. So when he came home from the military, he actually got an opportunity to work with Joyce Meyer's ministry as Joyce Meyer's bodyguard. So Joyce Meyer's is a televangelist. She traveled the world to speak, to do speaking engagements and all that kind of stuff. And obviously she needs a bodyguard. And Chris, just coming from the military, like, you know, he would be the perfect fit to be her bodyguard. So Joyce Meyer's actually knew Chris' parents because since they're in the same industry, and she actually knew Chris since he was a kid. So she did not hesitate to give him that job. And that job was paying very, very well. She was paying him like over six figures just to, like, you know, protect her while she's out. So everything was going well, but the only problem with this job is that, you know, Joyce Meyer's, she travels a lot, which means that now Chris have to travel a lot with her. And obviously Chris left the military because he wanted a less demanding job. And if you're traveling the world with somebody, then that's anything but less demanding. The boys really missed him a lot whenever he was away. Like, they literally had like a countdown timer that they used to basically count down the time that their dad would be home. So he was gone a lot and it really put a strain on his marriage. They started having problems in the marriage. So one of the problems that they were having is that, you know, Sherry had like a little bit of a spending problem. I'm guessing she was just using it as a way to cope because he was gone all the time. So she would just shop a lot. And because of that, whenever Chris come home, Chris wouldn't be as affectionate towards Sherry because they were fighting whenever he wasn't there. So when he come home, he kind of had like an attitude, didn't really want to be bothered. And also, Sherry was having problems with her in-laws because they never really fully accepted her at all. So she was having problems with them as well. So the marriage was just not going so great, but Sherry did not want to give up. She literally told her friend that, you know, she's never gonna quit on him. Like, she was not planning on ever getting a divorce. Like, she wanted to work it out. She was just never gonna leave him. And at this time, it wasn't really a good time to get a divorce anyways, because they were actually having some bigger problems that they needed to worry about. So Joyce Meyer's, she get a lot of threats. She's a preacher. She goes around the world to preach, and a lot of people don't necessarily agree with everything that she says.
It's perfectly okay for you to go ahead and have a good time while God's working on your problem.
And because of that, people send a lot of death threats. You know, people will be like, oh, your religion is trash. And, you know, people just want you to believe what they believe. And also, she would do like a lot of fundraisers, a lot of charities. So people would say that she's misusing the money that she's getting and all of that. So because of that, she would get a lot of death threats, but it's something that happens all the time. So she was like used to it at this point. But the only problem is that now, not only is Joyce Meyer's getting the death threats, but Chris is also getting the death threats. But he would get death threats sent to him through an email. They would threaten his family, threaten to kill his wife and the boys out of nowhere. So the threats were getting so bad to the point that one day Sherry was at home with the boys while Chris was in Hawaii, and she went to go check the mailbox. And when she went to go check the mailbox, she actually found a letter placed in the mailbox by someone who has been sending Chris death threats. So this letter literally says, "This is your last warning. your worst nightmare is about to happen. So mind you, Chris is all the way in Hawaii and Sherry is freaking out. They actually didn't mail the letter to her. They actually put the letter in her mailbox. So this means that this person knows exactly where they live. So you can imagine how scared she was. So she called up the mother-in-law, basically terrified, like, okay, what the hell? So now when she told Chris about this, Chris came back from Hawaii. I'm not sure if he cut his trip short or if he was already supposed to come back, but he came back from Hawaii, and immediately after he came back, he filed a police report, and also he asked his neighbor if he can put a camera on the neighbor's house that can pick up the house from a different angle, because he has cameras on his home, but obviously, you know, with every camera there's gonna be like a few blind spots. So the neighbor agreed, and the neighbor was actually a detective, Detective Barlow. Obviously he's gonna do anything to help to keep this man, wife, and kids safe while he's out of town. So on the morning of May 5th, 2009, Chris woke up around 5 o'clock, 5:30, like he normally do. And then he went to the gym. So he left the house like around 5:45 and went to the gym. Now, once he got to the gym, I would say probably like around 6 o'clock, or like around a little bit after 6 o'clock, he decided to call his wife to wake her up, because that's just their routine. Like, usually he'll leave and go to the gym and then, you know, wake his wife up so his wife could start getting ready and getting the boys ready for their day, basically. So he started calling her, but then he realized that she wasn't answering. So he decided to send her a text message just to see if she woke up. And then she didn't respond to the text message neither. So now he's starting to get a little bit concerned, because usually she would answer her phone or wake up. He called her a few more times and then he did his workout. But while he was at the end of his workout, he realized that he still haven't heard from his wife. So considering the current situation that they're dealing with all the death threats and everything, he wanted to be on the safe side. So he went ahead and called his neighbor, Detective Barlow, to ask him to go check on his wife and the kids. So of course he did it. He didn't have a problem with it. So he went across over to Chris' house to check on, you know, Sherry and the kids. When Detective Barlow arrived, he noticed that the screen to the back door was broken. So he figured they might have had a break-in, right? So he was like, okay, I'm calling for backup. I'm not taking any chances. In Columbia, where they live, it's like a really, really small town. So the police station is very small as well. So they send only about one unit out, because they can't imagine anything crazy happening. So they only send one unit. So when the other officer arrived, both him and Detective Barlow went in the house. So while they entered the home, they realized that the home was kind of vandalized, because there were spray painting all over the wall saying, I'm always watching you. You're punished. You have paid. They had their guns drawn just in case, you know, this intruder or whomever was still in the house. And then they decided to call for backup, more backup, because they're like, they don't know what they're walking into. So when the other units arrived, they actually went in the house. So while Detective Barlow and the other cop was inside the house, they went inside the rooms. They were just looking around the house, and then they went inside the room. And unbeknownst to them, they were shocked at what they saw. They were not expecting to see this at all. Like, this one completely caught them off guard. So when they went inside the room, they actually found Sherry and the kids, but they were all dead. So Sherry was covered in blood and the boys were laying right next to her, and all three of them were dead. So you can imagine how Detective Barlow feels, because he's like, holy shit, Chris is about to come home right now and Chris is about to pass out because his wife and his kids are murdered. So at around 6:56 a.m., Chris came home. So once Chris came home, one of the cops told Chris to stay outside. I'm not sure if the cops told him, like, I saw a report that's saying that he didn't go inside. And I mean, you know, I don't think I would have gone inside neither, because I wouldn't, I just can't even imagine, seen that, you know? So I saw a report that says that he didn't went inside. I saw one that said the cops told him to stay outside, which probably the cops did told him to stay outside, because if he would have went in, he would have contaminated the crime scene. So the chaplain told Chris that his wife and his kids were murdered. So everyone was expecting Chris to pass out and die. He was freaking out a bit, but he didn't pass out and die, basically. So the chaplain looked down on Chris's hand, Chris's knuckles, and they noticed that there were scratches on his knuckles. So when the chaplain asked him about the scratches, he basically started punching the gurney. I'm guessing he just wanted to be like, okay, this is where the scratches came from. And they took Chris down to the station, basically for questioning, trying to see if there's anything that he remembered, anything that was out of the sort, or basically trying to get him to tell them the morning routine and how the morning was, and if he noticed anything abnormal. He said that the night before, he was playing with the boys outside, and then he went in and they had dinner, and he put the boys to bed. And him and Sherry, they cuddled up, and then Sherry fell asleep in his arm.
Like, did you guys get any kind of argument or anything?
No, it was awesome. She fell asleep in my arms on the couch. If I'd just been there this morning.
All those police officers that you saw, they were all scurrying about the neighborhood. Why would somebody tell us that they thought that there was an argument at that house last night?
I have no idea. I'm being 100% honest, because there wasn't one.
Okay, but did anything else happen that you're not telling me? Chris, I'm getting the sense that you're not being 100% truthful.
And I brushed teeth and
turned TV off downstairs and
did all that stuff and I went around and checked to make sure everything was locked. And locked it up, like I always do.
And then, what was she wearing when she went to bed?
Nothing.
Nude?
Yeah.
Okay. Is that normal? Sorry. And what were you wearing when you went to bed?
So, while they were questioning Chris, they noticed that Chris never necessarily mentioned his own security tape. Like, you know, he never mentioned to give it up to them for them to look at it, but obviously they asked him for it. They noticed that he never mentioned it. So they did went back to the house and they took Chris's computer and they took other things from the home basically to help them with the investigation. So while they were looking in Chris's computer, they found some shocking things. So they found videos of him and another woman. And these videos were recorded when he was actually in Hawaii. So remember that trip that he took to Hawaii with Joyce? He was supposed to be protecting Joyce, and his wife was at home getting death threats, freaking out. He was in Hawaii the whole time with another young lady. So the police then asked him, was he having marital issues? Because, you know, they saw all of this in the computer. They didn't tell him that they saw it at first, but they just wanted to ask him. So they asked him if he had marital issues, like, was there anything going on? And he was like, no, we're good. We're perfectly fine. This is when they brought up the young lady. So he said that the young lady, her name was Tara, and, you know, they were just friends, and sometimes they would get a little bit flirty, like a little bit flirtier than they should, but it was nothing going on, like they were just only friends.
Anyone else outside of your wife in a romantic way?
No, Tara in Florida, I've talked to her a ton lately, but...
And what's with that? I mean,
just a friend, somebody to talk to.
So Tara was actually a cocktail waitress in St. Petersburg, Florida. What's even more shocking about Tara is that Tara is actually Sherry's high school best friends. They were best friends since high school. Like, girl. So police decided to meet up with Tara so they can get her story, her side of the story. When police investigated Tara, Tara basically told them that Chris is lying. They're having a full-blown affair. They were having an affair with promise to marry. So Chris gave her a promise ring and they were supposed to be getting married in January. In fact, she actually told authorities that Chris canceled a trip that he was supposed to go on to Disney World with his family and kids so they can go on a cruise for the upcoming January. They picked out baby's names, they were very much in love, and they were gonna get married.
How long have you been in a relationship with Chris?
Since late November, early December.
Where all of you guys been together?
Phoenix. Mm-hmm. And Hawaii, Maui.
What would you tell his wife when he was gone?
He would have just told it that he was working.
So Sherry was not aware of the affair that you and him were having?
No. I know she suspected, but, you know, he always would take pictures when he was going to sleep to prove that, you know, he wasn't sleeping with her or anything.
See, now to us, he tried to paint that it was a rosy, perfect marriage.
No. They never kissed. Never hugged.
But you had even registered on some wedding sites and stuff, looked at some rings.
I looked at stuff. But, you know, with his job, he, you know, can't be living with anybody unless he's married.
Had you guys ever talked about having children together?
Mm-hmm.
Crazy, right? You're sitting here planning a whole family with your best friends. Man, it's too much. So as the investigation continued, Chris's neighbors were actually pretty shocked to find out that Chris, he was already moving the boys and Sherry's things out. And also, one of the neighbors had put up a memorial for Sherry and the boys, and he literally dismantled the memorial. I don't know if he didn't want to see it because he couldn't handle it. The DNA test came back from Sherry, and they actually found out that they found Chris's DNA under Sherry's fingernails. So the cybercrime unit, they decided to start looking into these emails because, you know, this is obviously something serious. Once they look into the emails, they wanted to see if they can trace back the IP address from whoever was sending the emails. The name of the email address was actually destroychris@gmail.com. Very creative. So when they traced that back, that email was actually created on Chris's laptop. So, you know, what the heck. They also found out that the threatening emails were sent from Chris' laptop. So this crazy was actually sending himself these death threats and crazy threats. And another thing that helped them come to this conclusion that he was the one sending these emails to himself is because he would often misspell a lot of words based on the emails that they were reading. He would often misspell a lot of words. And one of the words that he would misspell a lot was the word opportunity. I mean, boy, did he struggle with that word. So they realized that in the letter that was sent, the last letter that was sent that was says, this is the last opportunity, this is your final warning, they realized that the word opportunity was spelled wrong. So they're like, okay, what's going on here, Chris? What's going on? You have some questions to answer, my friend. So around this time, the autopsy results came back for Sherry and the boys, and they actually found out that Sherry and the boys, they actually died from strangulation. So Sherry's body actually showed signs of rigor mortis. I think that's when your body's moved after you were dead. So changes after you were dead, I think that's what that is. And that was like really good for them because this also helps determine the time of death. So they decided to look further into the writing on the wall. So the color of this paint that was used was called candy apple red. So upon them reviewing Chris's bank statements, they actually found out that Chris went to a hardware store around 3 months prior to the death, and he bought the same color paint, candy apple red. So they reached out to the hardware store to basically, you know, pull surveillance, and thank God the hardware store actually kept it, so they were able to pull surveillance. They had backup to show that Chris was the one who purchased the paint. But Chris's father actually said that they bought the paint because Chris was going to use it to make a target so him and the boys could spray paint or shoot at or something like that. They went a step further and they decided to analyze the handwriting of the paint on the wall. And when they came back, it actually showed that the handwriting matches Chris's handwriting. So May of 2009, Chris Coleman was arrested and charged with first degree murder. So right after that, Sherry's family went ahead and filed a wrongful death lawsuit against Chris. This way he wouldn't be able to liquidate you know, their assets. So while Chris awaits trial, Sherry's friends, they basically started speaking out. And one of Sherry's friends actually said that Sherry had an idea that Chris was actually having an affair. Like, she kind of had an idea that that was going on. So April of 2011, about 2 years later, the trial begins. And the star witness for this trial was none other than Tara. And pathologist Dr. Raj Nader said that he could not pinpoint the exact time of death by Sherry's liver, but from what he found, basically the time of death was between 3 a.m. to 5 a.m. So this means that she was already dead before Chris went to the gym that morning, because Chris didn't leave the house until around 5:45 a.m. So the prosecution theory is that Chris carried out this affair with Tara, and he wanted to build a life with Tara. And because of this, he was planning on serving Sherry with divorce paper. And he bought the paint months in advance, and he spray painted the house himself the morning, and he strangled his wife and the boys. And while he was at the gym, he pretended to call her to wake her up just to have an alibi, saying that he was at the gym that morning and he wasn't at home. And then when the chaplain asked him about the scratches on his hand, he decided to punch the gurney so he can explain where the scratches came from. Chris's father says something that I think I kind of agree with a little bit. So Chris's father said that Tara was just somebody that Chris went to when Sherry wasn't doing her wifely duties, basically. And Chris was actually planning on breaking it off with Tara because Sherry started acting nice again. Which
Tara was just meeting a need that Sherry at the time wasn't taking care of. And
but I don't understand.
Well, I mean, every man's got his desires and every man has to be respected. It's built into every man. If your wife or doesn't respect you, then you're going to find respect someplace else.
So are you saying that Sherry was a bad wife?
Just at that short, brief time, she had stepped back from doing her job as a wife.
The reason why I kind of believe this a little bit, because he tells his dad everything. So while they were searching Chris's computer, they actually also searches his dad's computer. And they actually found images of Tara on his dad's computer.
Since going through your phone,
okay,
and computer, and obviously we've done the same with Chris's and even his dad's. And
right.
There happens to be a picture of you rather compromising on his father's computer.
Okay.
So
that's pretty interesting.
Yeah.
I don't know anything about that.
Which means that he was sending his dad everything. So him and his dad was really, really close. So they talk about everything. So he probably just, you know, told his dad that this is just somebody, whatever it is, somebody that he's seen. So another reason why I believe this is because if you notice, based off of all of Tara's interviews, it's almost like she was almost happy that this was happening. I don't know if she was happy that she ruined someone else's life, because you know you have people out here that are that sick. Like, I don't know if she was just this happy that she ruined someone else's life.
A text. I know. I know that. He texted me. I just thought I'd tell you.
He just texted us now. What do you want now?
Just said he was thinking about me and that the wake was at 3 tomorrow.
And also the way she was quick to testify, to spill everything, she did not hesitate at all. Which she did the right thing, but you're telling me that you were sleeping with this girl's man and now, like, she didn't hesitate. So if this is somebody that she loves so much and plan on marrying, I honestly feel like she would have hesitated a little bit before spilling everything. And I know you could be like, well, someone died, so this is different. But it's like, no. You didn't have boundaries when you were sleeping with this lady's man. So I refuse to believe that you had boundaries thinking that, okay, well, now that someone is dead, it's very serious. So let me speak up. So I feel like she, in her mind, know that Chris didn't take her seriously. So this is why it was so quick for her to just throw him under the bus, ready to be the main witness at the stand. She was just ready for all of that. And based on her energy that she was given in the interviews that I saw, she was just elated almost. Like, it was just very weird. So May 2011, Chris was charged for first degree murder of his wife and two sons, and he received 3 life sentences. in prison. So he's literally never getting out of jail. He was literally spared the death penalty because as of July 1st that year, the death penalty in Illinois was abolished. So that's the only reason why he didn't get the death penalty. So to this day, he still maintained his innocence. As of 2020, all of his appeals were denied because he's still trying to get out of jail. His parents still think that he's 100% innocent. His father literally said that it takes a deranged psycho to kill their wife and their kids, and his son is not that. His mother said that she would never believe that he did it until it comes out of his own mouth.
I believe he's innocent, and until it comes out his mouth and somebody can prove it, I don't believe he did it.
Which it doesn't look like it's gonna come out of his mouth anytime soon, because he did do an interview from jail, and I'm gonna play the interview in a little bit. But when you hear this interview, you're gonna see he has no plans of taking any accountability for this at all.
Did you kill your wife and your two boys because you wanted a life with your mistress?
No, absolutely not. I am 100% innocent.
So his parents, they're horrible parents, and I feel like, let's say you did hate Sherry, because obviously they didn't like Sherry, they didn't accept her, so let's say you didn't like Sherry. But when it comes to the boys, like, those are your grandkids. They're your grandkids. Like, wouldn't you want justice for your grandkids, even if it means that your son spend the rest of his life in prison? I mean, he's gonna do it anyways, but why are you trying to save face and not get justice for your grandkids? Like, they literally showed no remorse to those boys, and they were so, so precious, like the most precious little babies, and they did not deserve this. But that is all I have for today. Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, and I'll see you in my next one. Bye bye.